Hi, everyone. Good evening. Welcome. I am Faye Rosenfeld, and I am the Vice President of Public Programs here at the New York Public Library. Whether you're joining us in person or online, we are thrilled to have you with us for the launch of our fall 2022 season of Live from NYPL. And what a launch it is. Tonight, we have the immense privilege of hosting Abdulrazak Gurnah, winner of the 2021 Nobel Prize in Literature. He joins us to discuss his newest book, Afterlives, with writer Nadia Owusu. I'll say more about our speakers and this evening's program in just a minute. But first, tonight's launch is doubly special. Not only are we beginning our season with a sold-out event featuring these two remarkable writers in conversation, but we're also kicking off our first full year of in-person programming since the beginning of the pandemic. And we couldn't be more excited about what's ahead. In the coming weeks and months, Live will bring you conversations, readings, and performances with some of our greatest writers, thinkers, and cultural icons. Annie Proulx, Joshua Cohen, Stacey Schiff, Siddhartha Mukherjee, Saidiya Hartman, Andre DeShields, Nicole Krauss, Krista Tippett, Alicia Hall Moran, to name just a handful of the guests we have lined up for you this season. And let me share just a few more highlights. This Thursday, for one night only, Live presents a staged reading of the play Warhol Capote, based on never-before-heard conversations between the two that were recorded in the 70s and 80s and uncovered by playwright Rob Roth. Julio Torres plays Warhol and Cole Escola plays Capote. Next week, together with libraries across the country, we dedicate our programming to the ever more pressing fight against book banning. We'll have events at library locations around the city honoring Toni Morrison, also a Nobel laureate, as well as a longtime library trustee and outspoken advocate against censorship. Our programs culminate in an all-star reading of Morrison's Pulitzer Prize-winning novel, Beloved, at our Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture. Later this fall, on October 28th, Tim Gunn returns to host our annual Halloween Literary Costume Contest. Now, if you haven't been to this, please trust me when I say this is one of those unmissable, only in New York City, only at NYPL events, so definitely put it on your calendar. And we'll also continue to hold our monthly live happy hours with outdoor readings, drinks, and mingling right here on our beautiful Stavros Niarchos Foundation rooftop. Library rooftop, which as far as we know is the only free rooftop terrace open to the public on the entire island of Manhattan. So thanks to the continuing generosity of our donors, including Celeste Bartos, Manaz Isbahani Bartos, Adam Bartos, the Stavros Niarchos Foundation, and of course all of you, our wonderful patrons and friends, we're able to bring all of this incredible cultural programming to you for free. And that is the essence of our mission here at the New York Public Library, to be the place where all are welcome to gather in the pursuit of knowledge. So thank you for being with us. Thank you for supporting the library and for supporting the work of great writers like our guests tonight. I also want to thank our amazing team that puts all of this programming together, led by Associate Director Aidan Flax Clark and Executive Producer Emily Krell. Now, back to tonight's program. It is an absolute thrill to host Abdulrazak Gurnah this evening. He's the author of 10 novels, as well as numerous short stories and essays, and is Emeritus Professor of English and Postcolonial Literature at the University of Kent. In awarding him the Nobel Prize for Literature for his expansive body of work, the Swedish Academy praised his dedication to truth, his aversion to simplification, and his deep compassion in writing about the effects of colonialism on the lives of uprooted and migrating individuals, a subject he continues to explore in Afterlives. The book is available for purchase right here or online from the library shop, and all purchases made at the library shop do benefit the NYPL. And if you have a library card, which hopefully you all do, you can also check out copies of the book. Also, our wonderful librarians here at SNFL, the library, have curated a special Abdulrazak Gurnah-inspired book display and reading list. So if you want to check out other books that he's written or books that explore similar themes, you can speak with the folks at the outreach desk on your way out. And I have to mention that Abdulrazak Gurnah will be signing books at the end of the evening. And we are delighted to have Nadia Owusu joining us as interlocutor. Nadia's memoir, which is serendipitously titled Aftershocks, was selected as a best book of 2021 by over a dozen publications, including Time, Vogue, Esquire, and the BBC. It was a Malala Book Club title, a New York Times editor's choice pick, and was named one of Barack Obama's favorite books of the year. She's also the author of numerous essays and articles and winner of a 2019 Whiting Award. Nadia and Abdulrazak will speak for around 45 minutes, after which they'll be happy to take your questions. If you're in the room, you can write your questions on a note card. One of our staff members will come around to collect it. And if you're joining us online, you can drop your questions into the chat or you can email it to publicprograms@nypl.org. They'll get to as many questions as they can. Okay, let's get to it. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Abdulrazak Gurnah and Nadia Owusu.
You see, you stopped clapping too soon.
It's such an honor to be here with you today. I first encountered your work when I was in university, and the mother of a friend heard that I was born in Tanzania and said, oh, I just discovered this writer, and I think you should read him. And she was absolutely right, and I've been a fan ever since. So this is a great treat.
That's wonderful.
For me.
Thank you.
And congratulations on your recent Nobel win. I'm sure you've gotten this question so many times, but I'm going to have to ask it. What was that like to learn that you won the Nobel Prize?
Yes, okay. I try to make it interesting every time I ask this question. Well, of course, it was absolutely wonderful. But do you want a blow-by-blow account of...
Sure.
You do? Okay, all right. I thought so. Okay, so I was doing whatever, putting some logs away in the garage or something like that. Come in, I think it's getting near lunchtime. And, you know, you look in the fridge to see what's in there and this kind of thing. The phone rings. Oh, I started to put the kettle on. The phone rings. And these days, I'm sure the same is true here, you get a lot of uncalled for calls. and I thought this was one of them. So I picked up the phone and just waited, which is what I usually do, what probably most of us do. And eventually this soft-spoken, very courteous man said, is that Abdulrazak Gurnah? I said, yes. Who are you? And he said, my name is... It didn't mean anything. And I said, what do you want? And he said, I'm calling to tell you that you have just been awarded the Nobel Prize. So I said, who are you? What's this about? What is a prank or what? No. Anyway, he kind of courteously, like you would do with a fractious child, kind of went on talking calmly to me. You know, sort of. And eventually his advice was that you go upstairs, go to your computer and... join the Swedish Academy website, and we're just about to make the announcement. So I thought, well, if it's true, so what? This kind of thing. Anyway, I did go upstairs, joined the Swedish Academy website, and really just then, just that minute, his name is actually Mats Helm. I met him now, I know who he is. And he was walking through. There is that, I don't know if you've actually seen it, there is this drama. The secretary of the Swedish Academy comes from behind a curtain and appears in front, up to the podium, and then does his thing. So, because we've been there now, so I know the podium. He showed this is where all this sort of secret stuff happens. Anyway, so he was speaking in Swedish, but in the midst of it, he mentioned my name. So I said, yeah, it must be true. That's how it was.
Okay, well, that was lovely. That was a great answer. So we're here, of course, to discuss your really profound novel, Afterlives. And I'm hoping you could read just a little bit of it for us to kind of enter into the conversation.
Okay, all right. So I don't know if any of you have already read the book, but at this point where I'm going to read from is chapter three. One of the figures, the central figures, perhaps one of the main figure, I don't know, in the novel is a young man called Hamza. And he was a soldier in the Schutztruppe, the German colonial army in Deutsch Ostafrika, which is the German colony now Tanzania. And he's coming back from the war. The light is not wonderful, but I'll see if I can see. Their boat rounded the breakwater in evening twilight, and the Nahoza ordered the sail lowered as he made a cautious approach into harbor. The tide was out, and he was not sure of the channels, he said. It was after the Kaskazi monsoon, and in the period before the winds and currents turned southeasterly. Heavy currents at that time of year sometimes shifted the channels. His boat was heavily laden, and he didn't want to get stuck on a sandbank or to hit something on the bottom. In the end, after debating the matter with his crew, he thought it was too dark to approach the quay in safety, so they dropped anchor in shallow water and waited for morning. There were lights on ashore and a few people moving about on the quay, their elongated shadows stretched out ahead and behind them in the gloom. Beyond the quayside warehouses, the town sprawled, and the sky was amber from the glow of the setting sun. Further to the right, the dimly lit shoreline road shaped away towards the headland, which after a while ran out to the darkness of the country. Hamza remembered that from the time before, how the road ran past the house where he lived, and how then it narrowed down to the tight aperture that opened out into the interior. Out to sea, the sky filled with stars, and a huge moon began to rise, illuminating the heaving water beyond the breakwater and the frothing crest of the reef in the distance. As the moon rose higher, it submerged the whole world in its unearthly glow, turning the warehouses and the quayside and the boats tied up alongside into insubstantial silhouettes of themselves. By then, the Nahoza and his three crew members had eaten their meager ration of rice and saltfish, which they shared with him, and settled themselves to rest, stretching out in a tight cluster on the sacks of millet and lentils, which were their cargo. So he lay close too, listening to their conversation and their profanities and their gloomy, homesick songs, while the boat pitched with the surge of the incoming tide. They fell asleep almost in unison, their breaths drawing deeply a few times and then suddenly falling silent. After the momentary stillness which followed their voices, the boat resumed its agonized creaking as the sea tugged and pulled at it in its unrest. He lay on his good side, but he could not prevent the pain from returning, so he drew back from the cluster of men and put some distance between them. After a while, he moved away completely for fear of making them restless with his sleeplessness. He wedged himself into a space that provided some distracting discomfort from his aches, and somehow he fell asleep.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
So that excerpt actually kind of leads into one of the questions that I wanted to talk to you about, which is there is this theme of sort of return within the novel. There are many returns within the novel of people going back to a place where they came from or a place where they lived before to, for many different reasons, to search for their families. They don't always get the answer that they're looking for, but there are a lot of these returns. And I'm wondering if that was a theme that you were exploring through this novel, but then also more generally was curious sort of about the origin stories, the origin story of this novel, and what was on your mind, what were the questions on your mind when you began to work on it?
Okay, let me take the last question. It's always better to take the last question first because it's fresher in everybody's mind as well. Well, I wanted to write about the war for a long time. In fact, when I started to write, or when I was thinking of writing Paradise, not started to write, but when I was thinking of it, I wrote what is now the final episode in that novel first, which is the recruiting drive. Mm-hmm. And I wrote that, I remember quite clearly, I wrote that in 1984, and at that point, I hadn't yet actually published any of the novels, although two were already written, waiting and begging for a publisher. But I wrote that and then moved on to something else that I was working on, which actually in the end turned out to be the novel Dottie. In the meantime, that thing was sitting there. And what I began to realize as I was thinking about returning to it is that I really didn't know enough about period, and in particular that conflict. And I really couldn't find anything that was that useful to read about it at the time. It kind of also coincided with me returning to, not returning, I'd already returned in 1984 for the first time, but going back for a fairly lengthy trip, which I did on my own, traveling up and down, following whatever it was that I wanted to see and know and so on, up the coast mainly. Places I hadn't been to but had heard about and so on. When I came back from that, I started to write Paradise. But by this time, instead of thinking about the war, I was more thinking about what was it that would have made somebody like the kind of person I was thinking of do something like that, which is to say, join a colonial army, become a mercenary in a colonial. What kind of experience might have brought that about? So then, of course, I became interested in the boy and the circumstances. I should also say that I was interested in the period, because one of the things I saw in 1984, which kind of lurked in my mind for a while, which is that my father was still alive then. He was quite old. And I remember, and our house was right across from the mosque, our old house where we lived then. So I was upstairs, and I was watching him. Of course, if he'd known I was upstairs, he'd have called me down. Come on, let's go to the mosque. But he didn't know I was upstairs, so I was watching upstairs, and I could see him, and I could see just how slowly he was walking and how old he was. And it kind of came to me, although of course I knew this, but it kind of came to me, as sometimes things do, you see them, experience it again, that he was born in 1905. So he would have been a child during the period that I'm talking about. He would have been a child when European colonialism was consolidating itself in our part of the world, because it came quite late to us. 1896, I think, when the British thought they would offer us their protection. What are you sniggering about? Anyway, so then I thought, what would the world have seemed like to somebody like him growing up at that time and seeing strangers coming in and taking over their lives? Of course, the child would not have understood very much. So then that was the, is what the beginning of the idea of paradise, and to use a child growing up during that very, you know, crucial period, and how things would have seemed not properly understood. But we, of course, who are better informed and wiser, can see what he can't see, even though he is actually experiencing them. Anyway, so it's a long way to coming back to afterlives. But so that was that, and then I moved on and wrote other things and thought about other things and lived and so on. But I think the idea of that historical episode, as it were, of the war was stayed with me. And now, of course, I was, you know, accumulating a better understanding both of colonialism and also of that particular place in its particular history and so on. So then I thought maybe I'll have another go. I'll pick up, as it were, not so much the story of Yusuf, but on the assumption that there would have been other people who perhaps would also have made this rather now to us an incomprehensible decision to become a mercenary in a colonial army in that period. So then I did a little bit more reading, and I knew a little bit more about how to find things, you know, information, and then I wrote the book.
And that question of why would someone become a mercenary in this war? There are two characters in Afterlives who join the German forces during this war. One is Hamza, who we were introduced to in the section that you read, and then the other one is Ilyas, who is sort of his experience is a mystery to us. We encounter him early in the book, and then there's a mystery sort of that bubbles underneath the rest of the story. And we see the war through Hamza's experience, but Ilyas sort of disappears, and we don't know what becomes of him until the very end. And I'm curious about sort of the decision to have those two characters both make that decision for very different reasons, but then also the kind of, in terms of form, this mystery that's sort of at the center of the book, that even as many other things are unfolding, we're always wondering we know Hamza's war, but we don't know Ilyas's war. And I was wondering about sort of that choice as well and the effect of that choice.
In thinking about Hamza, the idea of writing about a figure like him, as I've already kind of explained why I wanted to sort of to think about why and how and what might have happened to people who did things like that. But I was also interested in the fact that he would return. Of course, he might have swaggered over the horizon and disappeared, and we would never have seen him again. But I decided that, no, I would make him go back to the town, and I would make him come back wounded. Wounded both by the traumatic experience of war, but also literally wounded. So even in that passage that I read, that he's hiding or trying to relieve the pain in his leg, as it turns out. So I wanted this person to come back wounded by trauma and also literally wounded, and to kind of reflect on how somebody in that sort of situation would retrieve something from that, would make something of life, would... You know what I mean? Yeah. And also, on the other hand, also wanted to have another figure like that, a woman, whom we haven't mentioned yet, who would have gone through a different kind of experience, but would also be coming through something. Mm-hmm. And I wanted, therefore, to see that if these two, as it were, could aid each other in some way. So that part of it was clear in my mind. As I was reading and thinking and writing this, I came across the story of a man called Bayume, Hussein Bayume. He was an askari. He was a Schutztruppe of Sudanese origin. His father was of Sudanese origin. He would have been born in Dojo, South Africa, probably. And he too became an askari. He fought for the Germans. He was wounded. He was taken prisoner by the British. And then he kind of disappeared for a while and then turned up in Germany. And he was an actor. And he appeared in several German films as a, you know, obviously a very minor figure, usually as a Schutztrupper. Because there was, after the truce, after the armistice, after the Versailles Treaty, there were a lot of people, including, of course, the National Socialists, who were very distraught about the loss of their colonies. They wanted them back. So a number of films were made celebrating the period of German colonialism in Dutch East Africa mainly, although they also had colonized Cameroons and they had colonized Southwest Africa, but they preferred to forget about that. So Bayume appeared in several of these films, and a woman called Eva Knox made a film. As it turned out, actually, I found out later, it was part of she was doing a film studies course, and that was her dissertation. She made this film about this man. Wonderful, lovely film. So anyway, at some point as I was working on the book, I read about this from in my research, a minor little mention in an essay by a man called Adiambo, who's a historian, a Kenyan historian, and followed that up, and there was this fantastic story. So he became Ilias. Mm-hmm. Not exactly fictionalized by Yume, but that idea of somebody who is so devoted to a colonial order, I suppose, which we know very well is not that rare.
Right.
It's not
colonial mentality,
yeah,
as Fela Kuti would put it.
Okay, but that's later.
Yeah, of course.
You know, but people at the time who were quite prepared to, you know, to embrace these colonial cultures, colonial clothes, colonial music, sound, food, whatever. And anyway, so then it was possible to kind of add different things, mm-hmm. Like the kind of fictional story that I didn't know anything about Bayume's childhood or anything like that, so I gave him a childhood. Mm-hmm. I gave him a new name as well. But that was the kind of like the link for me. Mm-hmm. But then, of course, I discovered that he was not unique, that there were others also like him who ended up in Germany after the war and who ended up you know, either marrying, as he did, a German woman, or just somehow making a living in one way or another. And it probably was just interesting to follow this through and mm-hmm. to find out about, like I said, you know, the Reich colonial Bund, the way in which the idea of recolonization was such an important part of the National Socialist program. But of course, it was overtaken by the horrors that then transpired in the 1930s and 40s, and kind of disappeared mm-hmm. from the public imagination, even in Germany. Mm-hmm. Coming back, though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Ilias and Hamza, I think, show two very different paths. As you were saying, sort of Hamza, you have return, and he sort of finds a new... The question of how do you rebuild a life after such trauma, right? So through his life, we get to explore that question, whereas Ilias's life takes a very different turn. He sort of internalized this sort of... Well, and it comes early in his childhood, as you said, that he actually attends a German mission school and comes to sort of believe that, as you were saying before, that they are there to sort of civilize the people.
Because they actually offer him kindness.
Mm-hmm.
They offer him kindness, they take him in, et cetera, you know. So he loves songs, he loves singing.
Yeah.
And he learns this. So instead of film, I make him a singer. But, you know, he loves songs. You can see how somebody can be seduced into that in a way that now we might find incomprehensible.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then another question that I sort of wanted to explore is this love story that's at the heart of the book between Hamza and Afia, who, as you were saying, she also is sort of rebuilding her life in a sort of new place. And through their love and the trust that they build, they are able to then create sort of a different story for themselves and for their son, ultimately, who they name after Ilyas, who actually is Afia's brother. And I'm wondering if you knew that there would be, that there needed to be a love story, and if so, sort of what the role of the love story in your mind was in the book.
Well, every novel needs a love story. Even if it's a love story gone wrong, you know, love fails, love wins, whatever. Well, because that's our lives, you know. I mean, our lives are kind of constantly looking, sharing for affection and that kind of thing. I mean, like I said, I started with the idea that there will be two broken people, if you like. Not entirely broken, but traumatized. And it was just irresistible to bring them together. Mm-hmm. But the interesting thing for me was how. You see, I mean, this is what writing is all about. How do you do it? You've got the idea. How do you make it happen? How do you make it work? And so the various misunderstandings about is she really Khalifa's wife, and things cannot be spoken. It cannot be a proper courtship in the way that, you know, most of you are familiar with, perhaps, you know, that you can gradually get to know somebody or something like that. It has to be done in difficult ways, as almost by subterfuge. And then the idea of the poem, the Schiller poem, came to me, and I thought, that's a good idea. You know, things like that, you know, that to me is that, but that's what, how to do it is what the pleasure of writing is, mm-hmm. for me, is about. You know, how do you make that happen, even if you know you want such and such to happen, but how to make it happen in a way that is both plausible, credible, and perhaps even a little surprising.
Mm-hmm. So you're a writer who doesn't necessarily have a sense of all of the plot as you sort of discover the story as you go?
No, not quite as bad as that. I have, like I said, I have an idea. So I knew, actually, interestingly enough, because I wrote the first, maybe a third or perhaps a bit more of the novel during a fellowship at the Stellenbosch Institute of Advanced Studies. They offered us a 3-month fellowship, so I went there. And that's what I did all the time that I was there. But before I went, although they invited me, but presumably for their files, you know, they said, "Could you send us a brief synopsis of what it is that you're going to be working on?" Mm-hmm. So I said, right, you know, usually it's a nightmare producing those things, because you're not always sure where you're going to go. You may have an idea, but you know. So I wrote this thing and sent it to them. And I was reading it the other day, and actually that's what I did. So it isn't that I just go in there, but I do go often when I start to write. I do have a kind of a hard core of an idea that I want to write about. So it would be, in this case, one wounded person, another wounded person, and they come back to a town that he used to live in and that kind of thing. All of those things were there from the beginning. As I mentioned, the story of Ilyas came midway. Mm-hmm. But things change. You know, I write and I think, nope, don't want to be there. I want to start somewhere else. So a previous chapter. How to situate, say, a fear story. If you know Stellenbosch, some of you may know Stellenbosch, but anyway, that part of South Africa, full of mountains. And we were walking, Denise and I, we were walking from where we were staying to the institute, and there's this mountain, mountains all around, but there's this mountain. When I got to my office as we were in the institute, I sat down and wrote that section of a fear and the hill. Well, just there. Things just sometimes just poof, just come as you're walking along. Sometimes you're sitting there reading and you reach out idly, get a book out for no reason, just boredom, and you open. Hallelujah. That's exactly it. That's what I was looking for. That's it. I call it writer's luck.
Yeah. I want to return to the history a little bit because I read somewhere that you, in another interview that you gave, that you said if I wanted to just read history, I would pick up a history book. But I think what's so wonderful about the way that the history sort of unfolds in this novel is that we do get a really strong sense of what happened in the history, but we also, it's told through the very intimate lives of regular people, which is, of course, how history plays out. And I'm curious if, in terms of sort of how you think about weaving together history and narrative, if there were particular ways that you wanted to bring the history alive in their lives.
Well, but not particular ways, but just to make it so that it's so that it works in a way, you know. So that, in other words, so that it's present in the context of the events, because it seems to me otherwise, if you don't have that context, then I'm not particularly interested in just writing a story about people scrabbling, making lives happen. I want to see why and what informs them, what kind of world they're living in, you know, what was going on around them, and whether it mattered to them or not. Mm-hmm. So often I put together small lives, as it were, or if you like, ordinary lives, in the context of larger events, which either impinge on them in direct ways or impinge on them in ways that are actually not anticipated by the narratives that we have. The important thing being that most of these events have some kind of story that already exists, but very often I think the stories are incomplete because they're often being told from the point of view of the Europeans, the colonizers, or even indeed from the position of defensive or victorious or something like that. And it's quite important, it seems to me, to not lose sight of the kind of like uninflected version of one that one might come up with. When I say uninflected, I mean uninflected by these. I do think it's defensiveness, this way of constantly saying colonialism was good, we did good, we did good. It seems to me there is a kind of defensiveness in that almost like shouting to drown down the objection, as it were, or the grumbles, as it might seem, of the colonized. So it's important to do that without seeming to be constantly saying, no, that's not true, no, that's not so. And the way of showing that is simply showing it and saying, this is what was going on while, you know, you're thinking those big stories about yourselves. This is what people were doing. And it's nothing remarkable, but that's what they were doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one of the examples that comes to mind for me of sort of that sort of the ways that actually history and power play out, we often think of them in terms of abstraction, you know, but they actually play out in individual small interactions between people. And so when I think of the relationship between Hamza and the officer, who takes a liking to Hamza because he reminds him of his brother, who he says was a dreamer, and so he sort of, it's a complicated relationship. In a way, he takes him under his wing, but in another way, it is still very much kind of an embodiment of the colonial dynamic. He teaches him to speak German, but then he has him say in German, you are welcome in my country, you know, and he sort of wants him to have this sophisticated grasp of the language, but then he says the only way that we can sort of help you or control the country is through savagery, you know, through violence. And so that was sort of one of the examples that stood out to me, that there's so much said about the colonial project just within that one relationship. And I was wondering why that relationship, how you came to decide to kind of have that relationship be central in the novel.
In a complicated way. But this is an attempt, as an afterthought, saying, I was thinking at the time that people in the service of ideology or in the service of a project like colonialism or like war, quite possibly have to suppress an understanding of what they're doing. So it's not that they don't know that what they're doing is brutal or is perhaps even immoral, but for reasons of social sanction or for reasons of a certain kind of ideological position which they have to appear to adhere to, this cannot be said, because to say it would be to say, actually, I am a fake. I believe differently, but I'm still doing this. And it will be intolerable to do that, to be, say, an officer in a colonial army carrying out the various brutalities that are necessary, and then to say, you know, I think what we're doing is wrong. I think in most cases it would be easier to suppress that knowledge. But rather than to face it. But on the other hand, one can also recognize the humanity of the other. It's impossible not to at times. So when you have a beautiful young man who's obviously unsuited to being the kind of colonial mercenary that they want, it's not clear that he reminds him of his brother. I try and leave that as vague as possible. But anyway, he reminds him of something. And so he cannot deny this young person's humanity, if you like. But what can he do about that? To show it would be to say what we're doing here is wrong. And he almost says it towards the end. But he can't say that. He's an officer in the German army. And I'm sure that will be true of officers in other armies, including the US. So it's that tension that I wanted of both somehow feeling that there is something wrong in what we're doing, but also being unable to do the next thing, which is to say, I don't want to wear this uniform anymore, which would be unthinkable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the complexities of the relationships really drew me in, because of course that is true in life. And another relationship that sort of, or actually it's sort of three people in this relationship, but it's Khalifa and Asha and Afia. So after Ilyas disappears, his younger sister is taken in by this couple. And in my reading, that this sort of relationship sort of lifts up a sort of feminist thread in which Asha, who's the sort of mother figure to Afia, sort of wants her to get married very young, and Khalifa sort of says, no, she has time, and also sort of advocates for her to get to choose to marry Hamza down the line. So I'm wondering if you agree that there's a sort of feminist thread in the book.
Well, I don't know if it's feminist or not, but I've always in all my writing been interested in exposing, if you like, the way in which women are persecuted in certainly the society I grew up in, but also elsewhere. Women and children, it seems to me, are the victims of this great power of the patriarchal figure. So I don't want to announce myself as a feminist, because I'm sure somebody will tell me, how can you, or something like that. But I will say that it... Hey. somebody's already turning me off. But I have, it's always been a concern of mine to say, you know, that women are not given a fair chance, as it were, in the cultures that I, the culture I grew up in. More so, they are in a better position now than they were, say, in my mother's time. So that's what I was after.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense. So I've also noticed, this is sort of taking a different track now, but I've also noticed that in a lot of your work, in a lot of your novels, sort of the role of gossip comes up, and in this novel too, many of the characters sort of like to sit and gossip, and there's a lot of sort of fun gossip that happens. But there's also sort of the sinister side of gossip, which is that you know, coming back to this story of Afia and how she is told, you know, to cover herself in certain ways because otherwise people might talk about her. And so I'm wondering about this role of gossip. Is that just sort of a reflection of the world, or is there something else that you're saying about sort of the role of storytelling and stories in communities?
Well, in the first place, I'm saying it's what happens in a small community, that people watch each other all the time and talk about each other all the time. But in another way, of course, it's a way of sharing a view of the world. Those people sitting around, I always have people sitting around talking in all of my books, well, not all, but several of my books. Mm-hmm. Usually three of them as well. Anyway, they sit around talking. And in a way, what they're doing is they're rehearsing their understanding of their place in the world. It doesn't necessarily mean they're philosophers or anything like that. It could be that what they come up with is something bizarre. but nonetheless, it's a way of sharing. This is what the world looks like to us. The other side of that is that, indeed, it can be a way of enforcing perhaps some intolerable sanctions on others. It's very interesting, particularly about the sanctions against women and their behavior and the idea of honor and all of this kind of thing. It might seem sometimes when you read about these things that it's the brothers and the fathers who are really the ones who do this. But another way of thinking about it, which is not my phrase, as it were, or my invention, is that it's women... the foot soldiers of patriarchy. Mm-hmm. That is the women, the mothers and the aunts and so on, who actually are the ones who police those sanctions.
Mm-hmm. So we have some questions from the audience now.
That looks like a lot of questions.
We'll see how many we get through.
I thought I would have anticipated them all and answered them all before you could ask them.
So this first question is about, it's coming back to this theme of history, but how much you think of yourself as a historian when researching a book like this?
No, I don't think of myself as a historian. Historians are much more painstaking, but also they're, you know, more restricted. They have to say where they got this information, who first said what, where the archive is, where the whatever. The beauty about being a novelist is that you don't have to do any of that.
another question is around, do you ever feel burdened by your role of depicting the lives and experiences of African characters to readers with little idea of the complex history of the countries that you're writing about?
No, not particularly... burdened by having to say this to people. Not, I mean, really, it's a very complicated place, Africa. Mm-hmm. So if I write about, if what I'm writing about, say, in Afterlives, would be as big news to many people in Africa as it might be to many people elsewhere. So, no, I don't think in particular that I'm writing to a non-African audience or an African audience or a South American audience. I am quite simply and truthfully writing for everybody, whoever wants to read it.
Mm-hmm. Staying with the theme of history, is it more challenging for you to write in a historical period, as in Afterlives, or in a more contemporary period, like in By the Sea?
Different challenges, really. I mean, I don't think it's more or less. Sometimes it's more difficult to write about contemporary things because you're more likely to be kind of like dated, as it were, to kind of... there are many writers who sort of like get hold of the moment, as it were. This is something topical, this is something important. And then time passes and it's... our understanding has changed and it doesn't look quite like that. So maybe writing contemporary is sometimes harder than writing about a historical period. But there are different challenges. I mean, they're all hard.
Another question about sort of this, that you teach post-colonial literature, and is that a kind of framing that you find useful or not so useful?
Do you mean, sorry, who asked that? Do you mean post-colonial? Do I find the concept of post-colonial useful or not?
The sort of framing of post-colonial literature.
So, yeah, but does that mean...
As a category.
For a start, I don't teach anymore, so I can be pedantic like a lawyer and say, no, I don't do that. But I'm interested in whether the question is really about post-colonial as a concept or whether I find it useful or not. I found it very useful when I was teaching as a way of thinking about teaching, as a way of saying this... This is how we can group certain texts which share common interests of some kind, but are in some cases quite unlike, but it allows us to bring them together because there are certain things they have in common. But I don't see it as a philosophical concept. Mm. I see it as a useful pedagogical or curriculum idea. Now, not unfortunately, but in fact, it has now gone on beyond that because so many disciplines have found it as a useful paradigm, as a way of thinking about what they do, including medieval studies. Mm. So you can say, well, how did the Christian Europe represent the rest of the world? Or indeed, how did the Islamic world represent Christian Europe and that kind of thing? So that is also a kind of a post-colonial idea introduced into disciplines like literature, anthropology, history, and so on. But, you know, it's not about writing. It's really about studying and about researching. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So this is a kind of broad question. How do you handle racial issues today? I'm not sure if this means in your work or more generally in your life.
Speak up. You handle them with care, in the sense that these are evolving ideas, they have a context, depends where it's happening. There are all kinds of racisms, including, shall we say, if you take an example of what's going on now in Mali, for example, or the Central African Republic, or Mauritania, the racism between Africans themselves. And of course, the more familiar racism of North America and Europe against people of non-European ancestry. They're all complicated. So if the question is about how do I handle that in writing, then I handle it with as much care as I can. How do I handle it in real life? Well, that's different, of course. You do your best. Mm-hmm. Duck and weave and hope for the best.
Mm-hmm. So I think we have time for one more of these questions from the audience. This question is, what is your impression of Queen Elizabeth and her, of course, and her relation to colonialism?
I don't know what her relationship to colonialism is. I know that she was the head of a nation, or a constitutional head, of course, of a nation, that for quite a long while was in the process of, or has been and continues to be in the process of reflecting and understanding its imperial and colonial past. Mm-hmm. I have really nothing critical or anything like that to say about Queen Elizabeth. I never knew her or met her or had anything to do with her. Mm-hmm. And it's clear a lot of people in the United Kingdom still love and have a great affection for her, and I do not wish to say anything discourteous about it.
Yeah. Oh, okay, we have time for one more. Let's see. This other question is also asking about sort of current events, but if you wanted to say anything about the attack on Salman Rushdie.
Well, it's disgraceful, it's terrible, it's wrong. Do I need to say more?
And maybe I'll just close out with one last question. You're probably extremely busy right now, but I'm wondering if you are working on another book.
Yes, of course. Well, I was working on something, and then the Swedish Academy did me the honor. So it's fine. It's fine. That's how it is to be. It's part of the thing. I'm very grateful to them. It's wonderful. And I love it. I enjoy it. When things calm down and time appears, part of the reason things are not calm is because there are so many new additions coming out, so many different languages, and so on. So, and they quite rightly would like me to participate in the coming out like this, coming out of the book, to meet the readers, to speak to journalists, and so on. When things are quieter, then I will go back and open that file and see if the thing is still alive or not. And if it isn't, then we'll start again. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it's not unusual that people have to do this, sort of take time out. But many of many past laureates have been able to return to working. And it's only a few more weeks when they announce this year's.
Well, many of us are looking forward to that next one, too. Thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you. Thank you.